What I liked about this facility is it was used during World War II to build airplanes. They built hundreds of airplanes here. And now our team is building a boat that flies above the water.
The tools that we use are at the forefront of the industries. You know, we're working to tight tolerances, and small differences in section shapes on the dagger boards can lead to relatively big gains on the water.
Technology plays a huge part in the America's Cup. It's been said that the fastest boat has won the America's Cup for the last 160 years, and I'm not sure that's about to change. The dagger board is the appendage that we fly the boat off and also transfers side force into driving force. Millimeters of difference make knots of difference on the board, so it's absolutely critical. It's critical in manufacturing and it's critical in design.
You tune your design for best performance, so you really want to understand how your design behaves, let's say the wing, how the wing behaves in the water, and you tune it by millimeters, by tenths of a millimeter to really make it perform with the best lift and drag.
What we're able to do now with the foiling technology is to break the drag barrier that all boats have. And the moment you can pop it free, you're effectively sailing on two little surfboards. You can't compare what we do now to traditional sailing. It's actually flying. When the racing begins, if you touch the water at any point, you're probably not going to win the race. And our job as sailors and my job as the skipper is to push the limits of the boat. We have a huge design team here. They can make the foils change the shapes and areas to make the boat go faster and faster.
So there's a fine line between making it strong and safe and making sure it's the fastest it can possibly be.
My military background is in United States Marine Corps, as a special operations operator in Force Recon. Getting your buddies or getting your colleagues or anyone who may need to be extracted from the mission out of the mission. So that's where my skill set in extrication and medevac rescue comes into play. This is a new breed of sailing. This is a whole new sport, a whole new technology, and it comes with its risks and its realities that this isn't just let's go play on the boats anymore. This is, we're doing 45, 50 knots.
All our equipment is going to keep us safe in the unfortunate case where we might capsize or fall off the boat. There's a lot of G-forces created in the maneuvers.
For sure, it can be a life or death situation on the water. If these two boats come together at pace, you know, there's a good chance there'll be injury. We've had it in the past.
What pains me to say that our sport is dangerous, and as a team we felt that harder than anyone, where we lost a fantastic friend of all of ours in Andrew Bart Simpson, and this stays with us and has coloured a lot of the things we do, the diligence that we have to the structural integrity of the yacht, the safety equipment and the training. And the demands are very, very high in certain conditions particularly. We have three or four athletes in our team that are undisputably up there with the elite athletes from any other sport.
This America's Cup, we've been sailing on the water, the boat's been quite reliable. We've been fortunate that no one's been hurt this round.
America's Cup is a sort of history of subterfuge and lack of rule compliance and all kinds of sort of bad things going on.
In a race as big as the America's Cup, there is a tendency to try to gain a competitive advantage, looking at what your competition is doing, going all the way to espionage, taking photographs, getting up close to the competitor's boat.
You definitely would deploy people to different locations depending on the day and what you're after. We'll sort of have a hit list of key topics that we want to look at.
At Artemis Racing, we know how important it is to protect our assets and our technology and our ideas. Confidentiality is something we take very seriously. Everyone who comes to visit us has to sign a non-disclosure agreement, so they can't share any information that they've seen. We make sure that our shed is shut the whole time, unless we're actually taking the boat out, so that people can't see inside and get any shots of our technology that way.
It's frustrating. There's no doubt when you've brought out your latest dagger board and you're very proud of it and you think you can have a speed edge. You proved to have a speed edge, and that evening you have five support boats 5 meters from your boat taking pictures. It can grate on you a little bit.
If we see someone on the water getting a little bit close, and they're from another team and they've got a nice big camera or video camera, we'll ask them to back off, and that can be done in various ways.
Get away shouts, and probably less polite than that.
Have the man-made amphitheater where you get great wind. It doesn't get distorted by any landmass around it. And I would have to say that it's going to be the best organized confusion you'll see anywhere in the world.
We're all pushing hard, and we're pushing the design limits, and we're really striving to win that America's Cup.
We're able to build a structural model of the dagger board and a fluid model of the water and run 10, 100, or 1,000 different design ideas and collect those back to the design team so that they know what the right answer to the question is.
I don't think there's anything more challenging in sport than trying to make a boat go as fast as it does and to also keep it flying. We're effectively trying to make a sailing boat become an aeroplane.
You go all the way to the edge of the rules, and you make the part perform as best as it can so that the team has the best advantage in the race.
There's just been a huge development in such a short pace of time.
If you took one of these craft and you sat yourself in the Amazon River in no wind at all, and there was 12 miles an hour of outflow heading towards the Atlantic Ocean, but you wanted to get back up to the source of the Amazon, these boats, in no wind at all, would be going back up towards the source of the Amazon against that flow, at double the speed of that flow, the wrong way. That's, for me, always something that illustrates how incredible not just these boats can be, but man's ingenuity and invention can overcome the force of nature and then use it to harness it to go back the other way.